So I'd like to welcome everyone to the second community meeting. This topic this evening that we're going to be discussing is complete communities and housing. I'm going to turn it off over to Marco from the municipality from the get-go, just to give everyone a few words of welcome, and then we'll get right into the content for the session. Over to you, Marco.
Thank you, Donna, and just welcome everybody. And it's excited to see another great turnout. This is our second session tonight, two more tomorrow. Our CAO, Tom Webster, asked me to kickstart the meeting with Madam Mayor. He'll join us in progress. But before I turn it over to Madam Mayor Haxson for her opening remarks, also want to recognize Adam Robb, our senior planner, who's assisting with the OP update, working with the planning partnership, Donna and Ron. Also want to recognize, I see a number of councillors are in attendance as well. Councillor Laurie Carruthers, who attended the first session as well. Councillor Scott Crone, and I also see Councillor Terry Foster. Hope I haven't missed anybody, but if others join in progress, so we'll recognize them as well. So at this point, I'd like to turn it over to Madam Mayor.
Well, thank you very much, Marco. I'm just excited to be here tonight and participate in this community meeting. I think it's really important that we talk about complete communities and housing. And I'm anxious to hear from the folks that are on the phones and on the call to find out what kind of ideas they have about East Gwillimbury and where we should be going. So thank you very much. I'm looking forward to it.
Thanks, Mayor Haxson. So welcome, everyone. I will say from the beginning, there is a chat function on this platform. You're welcome to share your thoughts using the chat box. And Adam from the municipality is going to keep an eye on that and let us know if there are comments that should be shared with the whole group. So we are here talking about complete communities and housing. This is the second in a series of four that we have planned today and tomorrow. We just finished one on growth management. So I really welcome everyone to the session. Before I get started, I want to launch one quick polling question. I think it's always interesting for people to understand who else is on the call. So I just want to understand if you're a developer or their representative, or if you're a resident of East Gwillimbury. I'll just leave that on there for just a second or two, just so you know. It's interesting because similar to the conversation we had just before this, it was about a 50-50 split between residents and developers or their representatives. So here are the results. We're just about absolutely evenly split. So thank you very much for that. This session has been scheduled in the context of other consultation events we've had on the project. So you might remember, and I'm sure some of you were on that meeting, we had a community visioning workshop back at the end of October. And there were a number of topics that were raised during that conversation, opening up the white belt, the role and importance of infrastructure planning. We had great conversations. We had a couple of different sessions. Through that visioning workshop, we were asking people also to share words and phrases that should be captured in a vision statement and thoughts that should form the basis of some fundamental planning principles. And this is the draft vision statement that the team is putting out for consideration, that East Gwillimbury will evolve as a balanced, sustainable, and complete community. There will be a range of employment opportunities, public service facilities. The town's unique villages will be supported as they grow, make sure development is compatible with their character. The character-giving elements of the municipality, like the natural areas and the farmland, will be protected in the long term. East Gwillimbury will also continue to support and celebrate the high quality of life for current and future residents. Nested under that vision statement are eight fundamental principles. And the principles all focus on a slightly different topic and area of interest. So the first one speaks to prioritizing the protection and enhancement of the natural heritage system, its ecological and hydrologic functions. The second one speaks to fostering a vibrant agricultural and rural community. The third principle talks about the creation of complete communities. The fourth is about offering and providing a full range and mix of housing options. The fifth principle speaks to infrastructure planning and investment. The sixth one, cohesive, vibrant, and connected urban communities. The seventh, resilient and environmentally sustainable communities. And the eighth one, providing opportunities for economic development. After the visioning workshop, the municipality organized another engagement event, which was chat with a planner. And Adam Robb managed this component of communications and engagement. The campaign launched at the end of March, and it offered an opportunity for anyone to call and speak with Adam, have individual conversations about the official plan review and about growth in East Gwillimbury. And Adam had about 15 individual conversations that were on the phone or through virtual meetings. So several hours worth of conversation. This engagement is supplemental to the workshops, the first one that we had, this one, and the other ones that we are planning. Through those conversations, Adam recorded notes and then created a word cloud that pulled out the words and phrases that were used most frequently in those conversations. And the size of the font indicates the frequency those words were used in the conversation. So you can see at a glance heritage, walkable trails. And through all those conversations, Adam identified a number of key topics: growth, providing more options for retail and commercial, the importance of trails, the importance of affordable housing, the need to plan for schools for kids and future housing for children, protection of the heritage, the identity, the town feel, jobs, and then an idea about making East Gwillimbury a unique attraction. So those were terrific conversations. I'm going to turn it over to you now, Ron.
Thanks, Donna. This slide really talks about the way we've been setting up our conversations and our work to date under a number of topics. And Donna just went through the vision and guiding principles, and that came from our conversations with the stakeholders, the public, back in October. We've been working our way through a host of topics related to complete communities and balanced growth, housing, community design, sustainability and climate change, as well as the agriculture and rural components of East Gwillimbury. As Donna mentioned, our previous discussion was about specifically about growth management. And tonight, I'm going to touch on the topics of complete community housing and community design. Tomorrow, we talk about sustainability and climate change and the agriculture and rural areas. All of these things are highly interrelated and integrated, and all of them will be dealt with in the new official plan, utilizing the most up-to-date policy frameworks that we're either required to deal with from our provincial directives through the growth plan and the PPS, or the regional official plan. So we have to update and create policy frameworks that are state-of-the-art and good for the town of East Gwillimbury going forward as it evolves into the future. Next slide. So comprehensive planning is a real focus for what we're trying to do in the new official plan. And that's really about linking long-term growth with the delivery of the necessary infrastructure elements. And that includes sewer and water facilities, as well as transportation and potentially an enhanced transit system. We know today that the municipality has a very good supply of land to accommodate growth. And that growth will be all about accommodating East Gwillimbury's share of growth first of all, within the region, and secondly, throughout the Greater Toronto Area and Greater Golden Horseshoe. Our goal is to meet provincial forecasts and to plan for long-term growth in order for funding for various provincial services and public service facilities can be anticipated and planned for throughout East Gwillimbury. We are not starting from scratch. The 2010 official plan in East Gwillimbury was a good plan, and it has good bones within it. We will be building on what was started in 2010 and moving out towards a much longer planning horizon to at least 2051. As I mentioned in the first point on this slide, the issues of municipal infrastructure, sanitary servicing in particular, requires a solution for growth that doesn't just affect East Gwillimbury. It is totally and wholly linked to future growth in Aurora and Newmarket. And it needs to be a substantial solution that considers the long-term growth of all three of these Northern York Region municipalities. Next slide. So this is where we are today in East Gwillimbury. We have the community of Mount Albert, which is a nice rural service center that has historic roots in the farming community and has grown over time and still has potential to grow and will grow to the edges of its boundary. Over to the west, we have the urban agglomeration of Sharon, Queensville, and Holland Landing. And those are really important urban settlement areas. They're still already approved urban development in and around all three of those communities. And then what you see in the white is what we call white belt land. And those lands are also expected in the long term to accommodate urban development. In terms of a complete community, we don't expect Mount Albert to evolve much more. We do expect it to grow a little bit and fill itself out and provide the appropriate levels of services. But the real challenge for us is, what does the concept of a complete community mean to the much larger urban area to the west? Also important is, what is the role of all of those lands in between that are the pale green and the brown blob? Those are specifically dealt with by provincial policy. The green is the Greenbelt plan, and the brown blob is the Oak Ridges Moraine plan. Those policy frameworks will also be wholly integrated into the new official plan. Next slide. So we're going to start with a complete community, and there is a specific definition of a complete community that is provided by the province. And what it really means is a community where residents can fulfill their daily needs in their own community. And now we're talking about access to jobs, access to housing choices, including affordable housing, access to public services, education, recreation, and potentially healthcare services. The idea is that you don't have to go to Markham to work or to Newmarket to go to get healthcare or retail and service commercial uses. It can all be accommodated in East Gwillimbury. Next slide. So when we start to further articulate that concept, and in terms of what we're thinking about so far in this official plan, accommodating a more fulsome range of housing types. And again, that means including affordable and accessible housing types that will be integrated into the community. Providing for a whole range of public service facilities, recreational facilities, healthcare facilities, education facilities, and so on. Opportunities for shopping, a more robust range and mix of retail and service commercial uses, restaurants, parks, systems, amenity spaces, cultural opportunities, and of course the important employment opportunities, which is a real focus of the town. We need to connect everything together. We have an urban structure that is evolving, and we need to make sure the transportation and hopefully enhanced transit systems work well and are well planned. We also need to consider opportunities for what we call an active transportation system. And that gets into ensuring that there are sidewalks, that there are trails for bicycles and pedestrians, and that everything can be connected without necessarily having to drive your car. Next slide. I'm going to focus a little bit on housing and affordable housing, because as we meet with people in East Gwillimbury, we hear a lot about concerns about affordable housing and how we might achieve that. And today, while there is a mix of housing types, the primary focus is on single detached house forms. So what we need to do is make sure the plan provides the municipality with the tools to achieve minimum density thresholds in the residential communities. And that means having a density threshold that promotes multi-unit residential development, including townhouses and apartment buildings. In terms of single detached, we can also work towards a strategy that makes lot sizes smaller and more compact. We need to plan for special needs housing. Special needs housing is a big bundle of types of housing that are important for a growing community, anything from long-term care to emergency shelters. All of that needs to be part of a housing strategy for the community as it grows. One thing that we will be adding is new policies for additional dwelling units or additional residential units. That is a directive from the province of Ontario. And that really means that every single detached unit, every townhouse unit, every semi-detached unit is permitted to have an accessory apartment within the existing dwelling and another accessory dwelling unit in a detached building on the same lot. We have to work around what the requirements for those are, but certainly that is intended from the provincial standpoint to enhance opportunities for housing that may be more affordable. We will be including policy approaches that are specifically intended to achieve attainable and affordable housing objectives, keeping in mind that the legislative framework to do that in Ontario is very limited. The only tool that's out there that we're not sure about implementation strategies is called inclusionary zoning. That's brand new. And we will be providing empowering policies, but as the name implies, that's really implemented through the implementing zoning bylaw. The municipality is a landowner, and in terms of dealing with affordable and accessible house forms, we need to understand what the role of the municipal land resources and other opportunities, potentially including community benefits, can be leveraged to achieve affordable housing objectives. It's a very important topic across Ontario, and it's a very important topic in East Gwillimbury and will be addressed through this official plan update. Switching gears a little bit to community design, the municipality already has some urban design, community design policies in their official plan, and we expect to build on those. And we'll be talking about public service facilities. And as I mentioned, that's the new phrase for community facilities, recreational facilities, and so on. We will be looking at opportunities to establish neighborhood centers within residential neighborhoods, and particularly new residential neighborhoods, so that we can include opportunities for small scale retail and service commercial uses wholly integrated into that kind of community. We're looking for upping the game on the public realm, making sure the streetscapes in East Gwillimbury are are beautiful and inviting and safe for pedestrians and cyclists, and generally promoting the principles of good community design. In order to promote them, you have to articulate them and tell people what they are. Obviously, with the active transportation elements, we want to make sure that East Gwillimbury is not only accessible by cars, we want to make sure that pedestrian activity and cycling are considered as equal partners in the transportation network planning. Next slide. The official plan will be focused on the principle of compatible development. And the compatible development context is a very well-defined phrase in Ontario, and it involves avoiding impact, undue adverse impacts, and enhancing the character of the community. We need to fully articulate the definition and identify what we mean by community character and what we mean by undue adverse impact. Not every neighborhood in East Gwillimbury is the same, and we need to be able to recognize that each neighborhood has its own character. And how is that to be protected? Going back to that definition of compatibility. We do know that the various community cores are at various stages of maturity and have our various scales and have various characters. Some are very historic, and that needs to be built upon. We see a big role for these village cores as character-giving elements to Mount Albert, Holland Landing, Sharon, and Queensville. We need to look at the size and the scale of those village cores, what's appropriate built form within them, how do we attract the services and facilities that we expect in a nice, robust village core that is beloved by the surrounding community. Part of that is updating the policy framework with the most recent elements of the Ontario Heritage Act. I think that's my last slide before the wrap up on next steps.
Yeah, so let's take a pause. I'm gonna stop sharing just for a minute and have a bit of a conversation. Love to hear people's thoughts on what Ron was talking about the variety of housing forms, about multi-unit buildings and townhouses, about smaller lots. There was lots of information in their opportunities to provide additional dwelling units. Because we have a good size group, it's only about 20 people. So you're welcome to use the raise hand function. You can get that in the reactions button at the bottom of your screen. Or you can just turn your mic on. And you can also use the chat box.
Hi, Donna. Thanks. I just wanted to also recognize, I see Councillor Rory DiClemente joined us as well.
Great. So
we've got a pretty good turnout of our council members this evening.
Yes.
Popping great. In to listen.
And just while people are getting queued up with some questions, I just wanted to ask one more question that of the residents that we heard on that first polling question. I want to understand where you live closest to, just so we understand the distribution of the residents that are on the call.
While that's going on, Donna, too, I'll just point out we have one question in the chat right now.
Okay, perfect. So let me just give this just a second more and then I'll let you read that out. Okay, so I'm going to just end that and share the results so everybody can see. Pretty good. Once again, this is similar to the session that we had this afternoon, a pretty good distribution amongst some of the centers. Okay, so Adam, do you want to read that question out in the chat box?
Yes, absolutely. So the question is for Ron, wondering if the priorities are too residential focused to be creating complete communities.
Well, that's a good question.
Yeah, I'm going to say that's fair. because I didn't spend a lot of time on the other elements, other than I did mention briefly about the importance of economic development. And as part of the growth management discussion, we did talk about making sure that we have an adequate supply of well-located serviced employment land in order to attract the appropriate number of jobs to this community. There are existing employment lands that have been designated and are protected for the long term, and we need to add to that inventory. So on the job side, on the employment land side, that absolutely is a key element of a complete community. The other parts related to what are typically called in the planning world, population related employment opportunities, those are institutional, retail, service, commercial forms of employment, and they come with population growth. So what we're trying to achieve in East Gwillimbury is a balance between population growth and employment. And the employment will be taking advantage of the highway infrastructure, hopefully enhanced transit over time, and the connectivity among the various urban communities in East Gwillimbury. So fair question.
That's a good question.
You're absolutely right. Perhaps my focus was a little too much on housing. But don't worry, the other parts will be dealt with.
We did just get another question pop up as well. I can read that one out.
Go ahead. Go ahead, Anna.
So the question is, does more density compromise the green or park space within town?
Well, that's another good question. Okay, well, come on.
I don't know if it was a Freudian slip that Adam said compromise.
Oh, comprise.
Okay.
That was a slip. Good catch, Ron.
So read the question again. Does more density include green space, more green space?
Does more density comprise? Oh, sorry, compromise.
Oh, it is compromise. Compromise green space. So do you lose the opportunity to have green space with more higher density? Ron?
Well, yes. Yeah.
Green space is a big word, a big definition. Certainly, if we talk about green space, including the rural agricultural area, there will be no intrusions of urban development into the Greenbelt area or the Oak Ridges Moraine area in this plan. Another shade of green is the natural heritage system, and we do not anticipate any substantial changes to this natural heritage system that is already identified in the current official plan, which is also in the regional official plan. The third part, parks and open space, are a function of growth. You have an existing park system, which was developed hand in hand with the residential growth that was developed over the last 25 years. And you will have a park system that will continue to grow over the next 25 to 30 years. Absolutely correct that on a per person basis, it is likely that park space will be asked to accommodate the use by more people. So the parkland strategy will need to balance growth with the types and scales of parks that will be necessary to serve that population. The Planning Act provides the municipality with the tools to achieve parkland through development. And for non-residential development, or at least industrial forms of development, commercial forms of development, the basic number is 2% of the gross land area. Lower density residential communities, the number is 5%. When you get into higher density built forms, there is an alternative standard that is more than 5%. And it can be an important number. And we'll need to have a conversation about what's the right number for East Gwillimbury. Every municipality in the Greater Golden Horseshoe is trying to establish what is the right number in terms of the generation of actual space. And secondly, what are the design parameters for a more urban park versus a more traditional suburban park? Because the needs are different, the locations are different, and the scales are different. Also the cost of building and the cost of maintaining.
Okay, thanks, Ron.
That was a long answer, I'm sorry.
We also have a follow-up.
Yep, go ahead.
In the chat. It is a long one, so.
Yeah, go ahead, read it out. Just read it out, that's okay.
So I look at the number of people attending the session and some communities not represented this evening, such as Queensville and Harvest Hill area. Do you feel the community members understand what an OP is and that they do have the opportunity to provide valuable feedback to this process? I would hate to miss people from important communities like Queensville, which is growing so quickly and will be quite large over the coming years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is a really good question as well. And I can help answer that question and then ask Marco or anybody from the municipality that wants to weigh in. One of the advantages that I found of the doing online meetings over the last 15 months is that through things like the polling questions, you can find out where people are joining you from on the meetings. And then it allows the municipality, if they choose, to do more targeted outreach to some communities that we think we're not hearing from. So we're nowhere near the end of the process, and there's lots of opportunities to be nimble and flexible with what we're doing. And I think the municipality demonstrated that with the initiative that they did at the end of March, which was chat with a planner and opened up the opportunity for anybody to come and talk and come and speak with Adam. Marco, do you want to weigh in on that?
Donna, no, I think that was a good answer. I think we'll continue to look at opportunities to ensure that we engage as many people as we can. And as Donna mentioned, you know, we're using a couple of different, methods here. I mean, the virtual meetings, we've advertised all our meetings online through social media. Adam sort of chat with the planner has been pretty successful. But as we continue to move forward and there'll be more public consultation processes, you know, we'll do all we can to ensure that we reach out to as many residents and businesses in the community to ensure that they're engaged. And we're really interested in getting input from everybody. But it's a good question. And again, we spend a lot of time in ensuring that, you know, we try and reach out to as many residents and businesses as we can to make sure that they're aware of, you know, these public engagement processes.
Adam, I saw that there was a follow-up question to
an earlier
question. Do you want to?
I can read that one for sure. So follow-up to the first question, and this was the original question of this session. I think we have to recognize the live, work, and play model. To enjoy East Gwillimbury, I would like to recommend that there are more pockets of mixed uses within future residential land use designations to ensure that communities are truly well-serviced. We need to recognize that East Gwillimbury is a very car-oriented municipality and cannot expect that transit infrastructure improvements will be sufficient for these high densities.
Okay.
I'm going to take a shot at this one.
Yeah.
And I'm going to break it down into the multiple questions that it is. Mm-hmm. Live, work, and play, a totally fine concept. I don't tend to use that phraseology because it's too limited. Live, work, play, learn, shop, eat, go to school, get healthcare. It becomes a very cumbersome phrase. And I find that just the three words is too limiting. Although I understand the concept and the concept is correct, that's what a complete community is. You can do everything in your community. The second question, more pockets of mixed use within future residential. I'm just going to, I did mention promote mixed use neighborhood centers, and that's what that means. We want to make sure that new residential neighborhoods are not simply residential communities, but that within a 5 or 8 minute walk, people can get to convenience retail, potentially restaurants, maybe some small scale professional or medical offices. So absolutely, we'll be preparing policies that allow that to happen. Now the last part, yes, you are car oriented, but we're doing a plan for 2051, and we expect that the car orientation over time will change. Exactly why we want live, work, learn, play, shop, eat, go to school, all of that in one community. Also, exactly why we want pockets of mixed use within the new neighborhood so people can walk. One of the fundamental concepts of good community planning is thinking about the 5 minute walk. And that's a 400 meter plus or minus radius. And we want to make sure people can get to school, people can get their daily shopping needs. We used to hear about a liter of gas for a liter of milk. We have to stop that. So yes, we expect that East Gwillimbury will need to evolve, and that the transit supportive built form will support enhanced transit. It's a symbiotic relationship. So the statement is correct, and the goal is to change that over time.
Okay, thank you for that.
Yeah, I believe we have at least two more questions here, and I think one is just a comment or a thanks. So the first question, is the town considering development on the White Belt, and what kind of policies will the town consider for these areas?
The answer to that is yes. The previous meeting was all about growth management, and the White Belt in its entirety is being considered for future growth. Some of it will be residential, some of it will be employment, some of it may be institutional, some of it may be mixed use, some of it may be retail and service commercial. All of the land uses will need to be accommodated. But yes, we are looking at the entirety of the White Belt in this process.
Okay, thank you. And then I think is there one more?
There is.
Yep, go ahead.
So the question is, will electrical microgrids with solar panels be emphasized for all new developments as they are currently doing in Pickering?
Well, we're going to be talking about sustainability and resiliency tomorrow, but certainly we may not get into the level of detail as to what the technology is, but we will be having a policy framework that supports alternative generation, energy generation opportunities, as well as potentially requirements for green building technologies. It's part of what we're doing, and it's something we need to look at to respond to requirements from the province to deal with climate change.
Okay. It's great that there is a lot of chit-chat in the chat box. That's fantastic.
For sure. I think that sums up the questions. Okay. The most recent two were, you know, thanks for this meeting and the information, but awesome. There are any other questions, feel free.
So let me take a minute, because we're just at 7:30, a little bit after 7:30, and I'm just going to go down through the names that I have on the list of participants, and I'll call your name out by first name, and I'll just look for your microphone to come on. You don't have to turn your mic on. I just want to make sure everybody knows that they have an opportunity to share any thoughts at all. And so on my list, I have Angela and Anne and Catherine. Just wait for a minute. And then I have Enio and Graham. And JC and Kevin. and Christine and Madeline. And that reminds me, when I call out Madeline's name, the presentations from all the sessions will be posted on the project webpage, as well as the actual recordings of the conversations.
Great, thank you.
Okay. And then I have Rhonda and Ron. And then a name that I'm just going to pronounce Shedwards. And then Wasim, or, and then Zia. Or Zia.
Zia has a chat box question too.
Okay, go ahead, Ron. You can, or I can read it out. Just to follow up to the question about the white belt, will there be new land uses designated for different pockets of the white belt, or will there be separate secondary plans for those areas?
That's a great question, and I don't want to say the name wrong, whether it's Zia or Zia, but that would have been a really good question at 5 o'clock, because it really is about growth management. And the short answer is, absolutely, we'll be identifying which areas are going to be primarily residential and which areas will be dedicated for employment, land employment. Within the residential areas, because population-related employment is intended to be incorporated in there, those would include schools, retail and service commercial uses, and all the other population-related non-residential uses. My guess is at this point, and we haven't landed on anything specific yet, is that we will identify employment and residential, and then absolutely, the municipality will be looking for secondary plans to fully articulate the mix of uses and locations. And that will be part, and again, I'm speaking a little bit out of turn only because we're not sure where we're going to land, but the secondary plan process will also be used as part of a phasing strategy for growth. We don't expect all of the white belt to be under development all at the same time. I hope that answers your question.
And then another question with this new plan: when the existing white belt areas are included into the new plan, will new white belt areas be designated for future growth?
Another interesting question. My expectation would be no. The province has been holding very, very firm on not changing the boundaries of the Greenbelt plan or the Oak Ridges Moraine plan. And your communities are bounded by those. So unless there's a major change at the provincial level, I don't expect that we'll be identifying any future white belt, which is one of the reasons why we think it's really important to plan for it now, so that we can plan for it comprehensively and make sure that we're understanding transportation facilities, sewer and water services, and all of the associated public facilities that are necessary, schools, community centers, all of that important infrastructure.
Okay, I'm not seeing other notes in the chat box yet, but while you gather your thoughts, and if there's anything else you want to share with us, I'm going to just share the screen again and ask Ron to go over what some of the next steps are in the process.
Okay. Again, this was great tonight. Good questions from everybody. We're still in the process of preparing our background study, and part of that is the continuation of our work with the region on the issues of growth allocation and infrastructure investment, fundamental to this plan. We expect that after tomorrow night, we'll be sprinting towards the completion of our background report. Part of the background report will be a summary of what we've heard, not only from the previous conversations back in last October and ongoing conversations we've had with senior management and council, but also of these four sessions over the next day and a half, will all be incorporated into the background work. Then we expect to be back in the fall before the public, all of you, with a draft official plan so that we can get into the details of the policy frameworks and the mapping. And hoping to get to statutory public meetings and council adoption before the end of this year or very early next year. I have to give myself a little flexible room. But we're carrying on, and there will be more opportunities for public consultation. More consultation makes the plan better.
Okay, is there anything else anybody on the call wants to make sure we're aware of with respect to complete communities and community design before we wrap up the meeting? And I'm not seeing anything. Marco, do you want to say anything to close the meeting on the municipality's behalf?
Certainly, thank you, Donna. Can you hear me?
Yep. Perfect.
Great. No, great. Another terrific, informative session, Ron and Donna. Just want to thank everybody for their attendance and some great input that we've received. And for those who have any questions moving forward with respect to the ROP process, feel free to call myself or Adam Robb or send us an email, and we'll be happy to talk to you. And any comments, we'll pass those on to Ron and Donna, and they'll be part of the public record moving forward. And just keep your eyes open for our future meetings. Again, we'll use multiple opportunities, newspapers, social media, and notices to inform everybody of future meetings. So this is great, and we have a couple more sessions tomorrow. And at this point, I think I'll turn it over to Madam Mayor for closing remarks. I also want to thank council members who attended, Councillor Carruthers, Roy DiClemente, and Terry Foster. Councillor Scott Crone sent me a note. He just had to leave a few minutes early to attend another meeting, but it's great to have them in attendance as well. So I'll pass it over to Madam Mayor Haxson.
Well, thank you very much, Marco, and thank you so much, Donna and Ron. Amazing ideas and information. I think we're on the right track. I'm hopeful that those folks that are with us tonight may wake up in the morning and think about something that wasn't mentioned or an idea that they might have, and make sure that they are in touch with our planners, with Marco's office or Adam's office as well, so that we don't lose track. We tend to listen to an evening like this, and the creative juices are really flowing, and then you think about it, but you reflect back in a day or two and realize that there were some things that weren't happening. And so please reach out to the town office. Marco can be found there, and I know Donna and Ron are available as well. Thank you so much to Adam. And thank you to everybody for spending the time. This is a process. This isn't just one time, and we meet and then we move forward. So please continue to talk to your neighbors. I do have I won't say a concern, but when we're doing it on a Zoom meeting, then we are missing people that may not be able to participate in Zoom for one way or another. And I'm hoping that the people that are on the calls tonight are able to share with neighbors and friends, but also perhaps at another time, a different medium of trying to reach to a different group as well. would be more inclusive and make sure that we've touched everybody along the way. It's a very important topic and it's very exciting for East Gwillimbury. So thanks to everyone for coming out tonight. Really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Mayor. So thank you, everyone. And I will end the meeting on everyone's behalf and end the recording. Thank you very much.